Yes, ma'am, it's visible.
Okay. So this is an introductory lecture on deconstruction, where I will be trying to introduce the basic ideas of deconstruction and the theorists, and also I'll also try to talk about certain challenges raised by deconstruction. As you all know, 1966 is a substantial year in the history of critical theory. At Johns Hopkins University, Jacques Derrida was invited for a lecture to speak on structuralism. Structuralism was at its heyday during those years. So he was required to speak on structuralism, but he gave the lecture Structure, Sign, and Discourse in the Discourse of Human Sciences, Structure, Sign, and Play in the Discourse of Human Sciences, which invariably inaugurated post-structuralism. We know that the 1960s was an year of certain political turmoil, especially you know that in 1968 you have the Paris students of Paris taking out in rebellion against the army, and you have them clashing, and you have the students' rebellion being mercilessly crushed. So it was an era where there was disillusionment with the grand narratives of emancipation. So this was the political climate of the period in which post-structuralism began to emerge. The basic idea of post-structuralism is difference. We know Derrida's coinage, difference and all, we'll be talking about it very soon. So difference, it is drawn from Saussure's linguistic theory, language as a system of differences. The per sound has meaning when it is compared to the ter sound. The sound has meaning when it is compared to the g sound. How do I evaluate the PG students of this college? I compare the PG students to the students of my college, or the students of your own university or my university, and this is how we try to talk about you. So you don't have an identity of your own. You have an identity only in relation to other people or other things. So language is a system of differences. This was the basic idea of Saussure. Language is a system of differences, but in positive terms. This idea was actually taken over by deconstruction, where they talk about this difference which can be traced to infinity. Saussure just talked about how these differences are very minimal, and through these differences you can find out the meaning. So structuralists were trying to say that there was meaning in differences, whereas the post-structuralists go one step forward to say that meaning is traced to infinity, which means that meaning can never be possible. So the paradigm of structuralism is based on comparison. How do I rate MSM College Kayangulam? By comparing it to some other college. So it's all based on a structure, a very logical, neat, systematic, a diagrammatically represented structure. You have a principal at the head, at the head of the institution, then you have the head of the departments, you have UG, PG programs. So you can have a very diagrammatic representation of the structure of your college. Similarly, you get a meaning in relation to the larger structure. And one concept that is central to structuralism is, of course, binaries. I hope that you have done a very detailed session on structuralism. So the binaries, for example, man, woman, truth, falsity, reason, emotion, central, marginal, culture, nature, Christian, pagan, black, white, day, night. These are the different binaries that we actually talk about. So man has an identity only in relation to woman. So woman is supposed to be invariably the opposite of man. Man is very intelligent, man is very rational, man is very bold. Okay, so opposite what happens to the woman. Woman is very emotional, she is irrational, she is not that intelligent, she is physically weak, she requires support. So these were the kind of binaries that created meaning. So, and truth and falsity, they were actually binaries. Reason and emotion, another set of binaries. Center and the margin. the center. Is there any disturbing sound for you? Excuse me?
No, ma'am. No.
Okay. Actually, my children are making some noises. So black, white. So these are certain binaries, and black has relation only in relation to white. Black has meaning only in relation to white, and these binaries were taken for granted. It was not being questioned. Whereas when you come to the post-structuralist discourse, they try to unsettle these very conveniently assumed binaries. This is how post-structuralism moves forward from the structuralist project. So Saussure system is closed, as I told you, neat, symmetrical, pictorial. And your meaning is taken for granted. You have a meaning which is available. So you have parole and lang. So parole would be the individual utterance, but individual utterance doesn't give you the meaning. What gives you the meaning? The inherent tacit lang. Similarly, you have synchronic and diachronic. You can actually talk about the historical development of language, or you can study language as it exists at any particular point of time in history. And as we all know, when English literature was introduced as a course in Oxford and Cambridge universities in the 19th century, a thrust was given to historical analysis of language, the Indo-European family, how they derived language comparison, rhetorical aspects of language. So this was being studied. Whereas when you come to Saussure, he says you need not go that deep. You can just analyze the meaning of or language as it exists at one particular point of time. Another very neat diagram is sign, which has two components, signifier and signified. Now, signifier, as you know, is C-A-T, is the signifier, and signified is the animal, that muse. So you have meaning very neatly placed in the signified. For example, the traffic. The red light is the signifier, but the signified is to stop. Now, sometimes these very neat diagrams do not really work. For example, I've given you the example of scarf. Look at my head scarf. So what is the signifier? The signifier is the scarf, the head scarf that I'm wearing. What is the signified? It could be read as a symbol of enslavement for some. Whereas it could be also read as a symbol of empowerment. So as Saussure said, meaning is not that conveniently taken for granted as we find in the structuralist discourse. You have room for multiple meanings, you have room for nuanced perspective of meaning, and you have room for a situation where one meaning doesn't become absolutely possible. Different meanings are also possible. So irreconcilable meanings are possible. So my scarf can become a symbol of enslavement. It can also become a symbol of empowerment. If you read the discourses on the veil and all, you can understand these. Another thing is the absent signified. We were always talking about presences. Presence made meaning. Metaphysics of presence, will be coming to it later. So sign is divided into the signifier, and then you have the signified. Where is the meaning actually? The meaning is there in the signified. Is the signified present or absent? The signified is absent. So the meaning is there in an absent signified. Then why do you privilege presence over absence? Okay, meaning of a sign is actually in the absent signified. And is it there in the absent signified? That is another question. Because one signified takes you to another signified, that takes you to into another signified. For example, scarf. What is a scarf? I have to explain what is a scarf. I have to explain the culture. I have to explain so many connotations of the scarf. So one signified takes you into another signified. In Pramod K. Nair, he gives the example of using a dictionary. You check a dictionary for the meaning of the word cat. Cat is a four-legged animal, and it goes on. So you have to check what is an animal. So one signified is actually taking you into another signified, or you have a sprawling, limitless web of signifiers and signifieds. So it is not as neat as Saussure or the structuralist imagined. meaning is dispersed along a whole chain of signifiers. So it's a whole chain of signifiers, not just one neat signifier signified relation which gives you the meaning. And an interesting word that Derrida uses time and again is dissemination. He has actually written a book on dissemination. Dissemination, if you go into the root, it can have two meanings. One is seem, semantics and all, that is related to meaning. Okay, so it is related to meaning. And the other, semen. Semen, you know how semen disperses. So you have a dispersal of meaning in the very word dissemination. So meaning is actually disseminated. Meaning cannot be taken for granted. Meaning cannot be linked or tied into one particular place, one particular post. It is disseminated. So structuralism says an abstract structure determines meaning. I gave you the example of your college. So there's an abstract structure and that structure gives you meaning. How do you rate a teacher in your department? By comparing that teacher to so many other teachers. So you have an abstract structure there and each element is actually, it arrives meaning or it derives meaning from the other elements. So this was actually a scientific project. Because in 20th century, everything began to be divided. Atom, which was conceived to be indivisible, was also divided. So it is divided and divided. And finally, all these components ultimately make up a structure, the larger structure. So this is what was co-opted into language studies, into literary studies. And this is how the whole philosophy of structuralism began to be conceived. When you come to post-structuralism, there is indeterminacy of meaning. So structuralism was talking about an abstract structure which guarantees you meaning, whereas post-structuralism brackets this whole idea of structure and it becomes indeterminate. You cannot find a single meaning and it problematizes the center. Center, any structure has got a center. When I'm giving you a lecture right now, who is at the center? I am at the center. I can control you. If you ask me a question that I do not know, I can actually not entertain you. I have the freedom not to entertain you. So even if I say that there is free speech, even if you are sitting in this Zoom platform or in this Google Meet platform with me, I am at the center. Even if I'm not at the center, your organizers are at the center. So any structure has got a center. This center arrests free play. So what is there at the center? The icons at the center, it might be me during this lecture, it might be your teacher in your classroom, it might be your principal in your college, it might be the government when you talk about the state. Okay, all these icons freeze meaning. They do not allow you, they do not give you a room for free play. You can move here and there. I always tell my students, when I take class, you can change your positions, but you can never decenter me. I am at the center. So this, my position at the center was unquestionable. Whereas when you come to deconstruction, when you come to post-structuralism, this very idea of this center is being questioned. You can actually displace me. If man is at the center in a patriarchal domain, why can't a woman be at the center? The woman is brought to the center. Okay, so this is how that the arresting of free play is being questioned by post-structuralist discourse. And there is a slippage. You slip into an abyss and finally you do not reach meaning at all. Whereas you have very taken for granted convenient meanings in the structuralist discourse. When you come to post-structuralism, it is a slippage because one signified takes you into another. You go on and there is an endless play of meanings. Play is a very important word that Derrida uses in his lecture, Structure, Sign and Play. Structure was a word that everyone knew because structuralist discourse was all about structures. Next is sign. Sign was also a word that we began using from 1916 Saussure's ideas. Whereas play is something very new. How the structure and sign actually leads to free play. Derrida was trying to question the structurality of structure, which we will be coming to in the next part of the lecture. Now, this was a paradigm shift. What is a paradigm shift? So you must know what is liberal humanism. What are the basic ideas of liberal humanism? One is the timelessness of literature. Literature is timeless. Shakespeare is for all people, universal. unless perhaps a post-colonial critic comes and rereads Shakespeare. Okay, so literature was taken to be of timeless quality, and literature enhances human life. If literature makes us better human beings, do you think so? Then English departments might have the best of individuals, which is not. So this was the assumption that was there. This was the liberal humanist tenet that literature enhances, it improves human life, especially when it was introduced at Cambridge and all. They wanted to introduce, inculcate certain middle class values, especially literature was introduced for prisoners and women in order to improve them, in order to inculcate in them certain socially accepted values. So there were certain socially accepted values which is also being thrown into question now. Texts contain essences. There are certain, and this whole idea of essences was being questioned by the 20th century existentialist thinker Jean-Paul Sartre, who said existence precedes essence. There is nothing called essences. So you have two movements. One is the essentialist movement, the other is anti-essentialist, which are always at loggerheads. I'm not going into that. But talking about this, this was a paradigm shift. Now let me just try to tell you a basic distinction between new criticism and deconstruction. Both of them talk about ambiguity, both of them talk about the different meanings possible. Okay, but new criticism says that there might be different determinate meanings. The meanings are determinate. For example, I say this meaning is possible, so one of you say no, this meaning is possible. So both these meanings are determinate. Whereas when you come to deconstruction, they do not agree. They say the meaning is itself indeterminate. William Empson has written a famous book called Seven Types of Ambiguity. And he details the seven types of ambiguity. It was a new critical text. And in the seventh type he enumerates linguistic indeterminacy, which actually foreshadows the indeterminacy which is celebrated by deconstruction in the years to come. Empson must not have intended it, but his idea is actually an offshoot of the ideas which were celebrated by deconstruction. Now, structuralism and post-structuralism both were anti-humanist. Why were they anti-humanist? Because they displaced human being. Structure displaced human being and said that structuralism displaced human beings and anointed structure at the center. Post-structuralism and deconstruction says there are no structures as such. Both of them were anti-humanist. So if we take the tradition from Greek times, for example, from Plato, Aristotle, you can see that it was largely humanist. For example, before Plato, Aristotle and Socrates, you had the age of Homer and Hesiod, which was the mythological age, where different stories were used to for people to make sense of the world. So for example, the Greek god Thor was angry, so he swung his hammer and then there was lightning and thunder. So these stories were there. This was the mythological age. Then you have the classical age, which is the age of Socrates, Aristotle and Plato. We know that one of the foremost contributions of Greek civilization is the bequeathing of rationality to Western philosophy. So who is actually rational? It is man. So man was placed at the center. So the humanist tradition was inaugurated there. After that, we have the Christian tradition. Okay, Christian tradition, where you have a man being replaced by God. Because you are sent, Adam and Eve, you have the fall, they are sent to earth, and then you have some testing times, trials and tribulations. Finally, you reach heaven, a teleological perspective. So this was where God was at the center. So even though God was at the center, it was largely humanist because God created man in his image. God created man as a unique creation, and this man was supposed to, or he had hegemony over the world. So in that sense, I would say it was also humanist. And then this was a long period. We know that it was a long period until Renaissance humanism. In Renaissance, during the period of Renaissance humanism, as we find in Shakespeare, what a piece of work is man, how infinite in reason, how noble in faculty. So the Renaissance humanist spirit is coming over. Okay, and this during this time, again, the focus shifted to man. because they were drawing on the philosophy of the Greek scholars of classical period, Socrates, Aristotle and Plato. So this was also humanist. Then we talk about the neoclassical period, where rules were given importance, and still man's intelligence was being valorized, because Newton was the greatest scientist of that particular period, and Alexander Pope writes about Newton. God said there was light and there was Newton. So Newton was somebody who brought light to the world. God actually controls the world. There is an order. That order is reflected in nature and even in literature. So we have to follow these rules in order to write. Then you have the Romantic Age, of course, where imagination was being celebrated. Romanticism was actually a response to European Enlightenment, which gave too much importance to rationality, which gave too much importance to reason. So this celebration of intellect, the poet becomes a philosopher. So again, it is humanist. And then you come to the new critical phase, where it was the words on the text that produced meaning. And this new critical tradition was carried forward to the structuralist and the post-structuralist. And by the structuralist period, it became anti-humanist, because man was more or less decentered. And when you come to the post-structuralist period, there was a complete decentering of the human being. So post-structuralism celebrates contingency, indeterminacy, and multiple readings. Difference and deferral is inherent in language itself, drawing on Saussure's idea of differences. Because any language, anything is made up of differences. This difference gets extended to infinity, and also because it gets extended to infinity, it is a deferral. So it's a coinage of difference and deference. So he coined a new word. Derrida coined a new word, difference. So at the heart of existence is not essence, but difference. It is difference that actually brings you identity. Difference has neither essence nor existence. Difference with an A. Now, this difference with an A is a very tricky thing, because Derrida does not pronounce it difference as we normally pronounce. Derrida wanted to keep us vague on what he is meaning. So he would use the word difference in his essay, and what we have to do is we have to check the text in order to see whether it is difference with an A or difference with an E. So the letter A was silent. By making the letter A silent and by making the new word difference be pronounced as the other word difference, he was trying to challenge the opposition or the binary between speech and writing. Speech was always looked upon as the origin, and writing was looked upon as the handmade or a secondary thing. But how do you understand the meaning of difference? Only if you look at the written script. So by coining, by this neologism, by this new graphic innovation, Derrida was trying to show that speech is not superior to writing. So to subvert the traditional privileging of speech over writing, as well as the distinction between the sensible and the intelligible. The sensible and the intelligible are two other binaries, because sensible means something that you can touch with your senses. So C-A-T, cat, I write C-A-T, I can touch it. This is sensible, or I can see it. Okay, whereas the animal cat, which it refers to, is the intelligible. So every sign has two aspects, the sensible and the intelligible. So by this new coinage, Derrida was trying to unsettle this very neat binary between the sensible and the intelligible. So differ means non-identity. I'm different from you. You are different from me. Okay. Defer means postponing. These two words were combined to form a new word, difference, which is the origin of differences. It cannot be heard. So this was a very, a marked departure from the classical paradigm, where you have meaning being vested in the signified. All these signifieds finally lead you to a transcendental signified. That transcendental signified gives you meaning. Whereas for Derrida, all these signifieds endlessly slip into another I was trying to put upon this word in order to make it similar to ontology, O-N-T-O-L-O-G-Y, which brings in the idea of existence and being. So by this verbal play, he was trying to actually unsettle this very neat binaries which were taken for granted by the structuralist paradigm. So by this coinage, by this neologism, difference or ontology, he was playing upon the binary between the sensible and the intelligible on one side, speech and writing, and also presence and absence. I hope it is clear. Sensible and intelligible, because the concept of sign is itself built upon this very neat idea of the sensible and the intelligible. By using this coinage, he is trying to blur the boundary between them, and also speech and writing, because this is something that is realized in writing, and also presence and absence, because this is something that is absent. Difference, the A is absent, at least when you speak. Now, who were the major philosophers who ushered in these concepts, the concepts of post-structuralism? First, of course, is Friedrich Nietzsche, and his most important pronouncement was, "Dead are all the gods." Phenomenally, earlier we believed in the transcendental signified, which was God. Now, Nietzsche questions this. So he raises skepticism about truth. Knowledge and truth are effective instruments, not transcendent entities. Earlier, we conveniently assumed that knowledge and truth are transcendent entities, but Nietzsche questions this, saying that these are merely effective instruments. And just to know means you're just trying to impose categories on chaotic processes. So this is what the structuralist paradigm we were trying to do. Nature is very chaotic. You try to impose certain categories, and these categories are not universal, or these categories are not transcendent entities. They are something that are done, that are done by human beings. He also investigated the true genealogies of modern moral values. Morality is something that is given. Morality cannot be questioned. Nietzsche goes into the genealogies, how these moral values were produced. So that is why, in one sense, Nietzsche inaugurated post-structuralism, because he was trying to question structures, the structure of morals, the structure of knowledge. So in that sense, he was going beyond the structure. That is why his ideas have contributed or have inspired post-structuralist thinkers. Nietzsche was, of course, an anti-philosopher, because he was questioning all sorts of philosophies. His views on language and meaning and his genealogical studies give testimony to the fact that he is an anti-philosopher. Nietzsche, an affirmation of the thinking of free play. Nietzsche talks about a free play where there is no center. Okay, so this is an idea that Derrida takes up in his essay. Another major thinker was, of course, the 20th century thinker Heidegger, who says language is not a tool. We have the representational theory of language, isn't it? That is, we have a very convenient reality. Language just represents it. So we have different theories of language, especially during the 20th century. We have the linguistic turn, where these analytic philosophers like Frege, Russell and all came, and they tried to look at language in a mathematical way, because they were mathematicians. So they tried to draw upon certain models, mathematical models, in order to talk about language. So this was analytical philosophy, but Heidegger departs from them, and Heidegger said that we are made up of language. It is language that speaks, not we. We do not use language. In fact, language is something that speaks through us. So in that sense, human agency is reduced. Coming back to my earlier point, this was anti-humanist. So why was it anti-humanist? Because earlier we have language in our hands, and with that language we could make sense of things. But here, human agency was being diminished, because it is language that speaks. This idea is taken up by Derrida in his essay, where he tries to distinguish between the bricklayer and the engineer. The idea of intellectual bricolage was also talked about by Gerald Genet in his essay. So bricklayer is a person who takes something that is available in order to create something new, whereas an engineer is somebody who creates something new. So God might be an engineer. Okay, so the very concept of God is being questioned, and they try to argue that the whole concept of an engineer is a myth. you always use something that is available in order to produce something new. So speaking is also a form of writing. It is not that speaking is very, for example, I am speaking, so my thoughts come directly from my brain, so it is immediate, so it is much more authentic than what I write. This was the traditional conception, but when you come to the new idea, what happens is speaking is also a form of writing because they rely on language, and language, of course, cannot be relied. And this this division between the critic and the writer was questioned during the structuralist phase itself. Roland Barthes' essay Structuralist Activity, he tries to say that both the critic and the writer are doing the same thing. They are doing a sort of bricolage. The writer uses the materials from the universe, whereas the critic uses the material in the writer's text. So he tries to, during the structuralist phase itself, they were trying to diminish the boundary between the critic and the writer. The word deconstruction is taken from from Heidegger's word destruction, where he was trying to argue for a loosening up of the old tradition of ontology. So the tradition of ontology was fixed. It was conceived in a certain way, and Heidegger was trying to disentangle them. And Derrida's another argument is that of traces. Every word has got traces of words that come before or context in which that word had been used earlier. You have words gone after and words gone before and words coming after. For example, if I use the word democracy for the millionth time, that millionth time has the traces of all the times when the word democracy had been used. So no sign is pure, no sign is virginal. This is the idea that they're trying to show. An iterability of sign. Every sign is repeatable. When you repeat, the traces carry forward and that create new meanings. Here is just a sentence. This is just a poem in order to show how deconstruction works. This is a very minor example. How mournfully the wind of autumn pines upon the mountainside as the day declines. How mournfully the wind of autumn pines upon the mountainside as the day declines. You can read this in two ways. One is wind is taken as an object and wind is actually pining. So the wind is pining mournfully upon the mountainside, or you can take autumn pines as a noun, pine tree. How mournfully the wind of autumn pines, within the autumn pines upon the mountainside as the day declines. So there are two different meanings that are possible, and according to deconstruction, both these meanings are equally possible, which means meaning is indeterminate. Another major post-structuralist thinker was Foucault. Foucault thought about structures. So why was Foucault a post-structuralist thinker? Because he was thinking about structures. Archaeology of Knowledge is one of his primary works, where he tries to talk about how the categorization of the normal and the abnormal vary over time. We have been seeing that certain things that were abnormal are now normal. For example, I'm looking at my screen, I'm not even seeing you, I'm talking. This might be abnormal last year, but today this has become the norm. So categorization of normal and abnormal vary over time. Especially when you talk about the homosexual discourse, sexuality has been decriminalized in many of the countries of the world. I think 2 days back, Pope has also was arguing for the rights of homosexuals, which was actually very surprising, because Christianity was a religion that has always objected to homosexuality. So what was actually earlier, people were taken to hospitals and cured because if they were homosexuals. So the concept of normal and abnormal vary over time. Foucault himself was taken to a psychiatrist for his homosexual inclinations. We know Foucault died of AIDS. Okay, and perhaps that was what made Foucault think about this. So Foucault, in his Madness and Civilization, he talks about how the mental asylum came into being. Leprosy, in 15th century, leprosy was a disease. So all these lepers were quarantined so that it will not spread. But by the end of the 15th century, 16th century, this disease was cured, but the structures remained. So in that structure, you have criminals, madmen, sick people, unemployed, all of them locked together. Okay, so this locking, this quarantining was something. So he's trying to show how these things came evolved. So it is not that one fine morning it happened, but how these structures came to be evolved, how these structures were associated with power. For example, being unemployed is a crime, or being unproductive is a crime in these days. That is why when your parents age, you find them very unproductive, so you send them to old age homes. So this is the new norm. So you have to be productive. So so earlier you did not have prisons for madmen or criminals separately. All of them were locked together. But even before, you had certain spaces where the village thief or the madman could exist normally in a society. Sick people, they were not quarantined. If, for example, in the movie Misha Madhavan, you have the thief living among the people. No, the thief is not locked in. So in certain in such epistemologies, it was possible for criminals, madmen, sick people, unemployed, all of them to live together in a single space, which was actually being questioned, and new structures were being imposed in order to control them. Another major work of Foucault was The Birth of the Clinic. So the clinic was born when the doctor becomes the savior, the doctor taking rounds, the doctor becomes a powerful figure, the doctor prescribes and proscribes certain kinds of lifestyle, which is actually related to power. Another work was The Order of Things, where he talks about how we make sense of categories. So Foucault was trying to talk about the linkage between knowledge and power, how bodies are regulated by the state, and his idea of the panopticon, which was taken from Jeremy Bentham. It is a very elaborate concept. I will not be going into that. But even now we see how surveillance has become, even during this pandemic period, especially the Arogya Setu app, okay, download it tracks each of your movements. So how surveillance is being invaded into our everyday privacy, and how it is linked to power. Writing has been secondary, okay, right from Plato until Rousseau, which is actually questioned by Derrida. And the idea of logocentrism, phonocentrism, and transcendental signified, these are also questioned by deconstruction. Logocentrism means it talks about essences. It talks about a core. It talks about a truth at the center. Phonocentrism means speech is privileged over writing. And transcendental signified is all the signifieds taking you into an ultimate signified, which controls and governs meaning. So any thought which depends on an unassailable foundation is metaphysical. So Derrida is always trying to question metaphysics of presence. What is metaphysics? How did the word metaphysics come into being? Aristotle was a writer was a great philosopher who wrote about a lot of books on physics, and also on certain books, certain ideas, certain themes which were not beyond physics. So when his works were being compiled, his compiler put it under one head, physics, and the other one, which was beyond physics. Physics deals about the observable world, whereas the other one, which talks about truth, value, God, and all these things. So these was classified under metaphysical. So metaphysical is something that generally, even now, we use to talk about something that we do not normally observe. Metaphysics is beyond science. So metaphysics is talk about the transcendental signified, an original moment, a golden age, or an unarguable meaning for an utterance because it is divine. Okay, so this is the idea of metaphysics. Metaphysics of presence is the notion that there is a transcendental signified, a God word that underlines all philosophical talk and guarantees meaning. This guarantee of meaning is actually taken away by Derrida. Rousseau's idea of noble savage. Now, we were talking about how binaries are being deconstructed. One of the major binary was nature and culture. And Rousseau was an Enlightenment thinker. We know that it was Rousseau's ideas that actually gave impetus to Wordsworth's romanticism. So Rousseau was romanticizing nature, whereas his friend Voltaire was arguing for civilization. So you have culture, nature, binary, and Voltaire was arguing for culture, whereas Rousseau was arguing for nature. Rousseau believed that civilization corrupts, culture corrupts, and we live in a pristine state in nature, which has to be from which we have to learn. So that was his idea of the noble savage. This noble savage was innocent of writing. He was innocent of private property. He was innocent. So this was actually good. So you have this noble savage who is very good. And now what happens is, Derrida's idea is that even these noble savages were governed by certain rules, even if they were not written. So how can you say that they were innocent of rules? So we'll come to that when we discuss Levi-Strauss very soon. Rousseau was a writer. Now, Rousseau is arguing for speech. Rousseau is arguing for nature by in his writings. His writing is itself a mark of civilization and culture. So Derrida is trying to problematize the whole thing. Rousseau was arguing for the purity of speech through his writings, which is itself problematic. And he also talks about Rousseau's ideas of masturbation, especially in his confessions. In his confessions, he has talked about how his erotic masturbation was much more erotic than his the real sex that he had with certain women. So the whole idea of masturbation is based on fantasy, which is actually absence. So it is an absent entity that actually gives pleasure, real pleasure to Rousseau. So this is how Derrida tries to unsettle that. So these are the Derrida tries to question the ideas of Plato, Rousseau, and Levi-Strauss primarily. Plato's idea of pharmakos. Pharmakos is a civil purification ritual. It happens, for example, in Oedipus and all, you know that there was pestilence and they were thinking that somebody is there in the city who is responsible for that, and it happens to be Oedipus. So the reason for the pestilence is something within, and that person has to be purged. In many tribal societies, kings were actually put to death in order to purify the society. And in Egyptian civilization, you have this the goddess Isis. She was satisfied by throwing a girl into the Nile River so that the river gets replenished and next year you have plenty of water, which is useful for their livelihood. So this is what you mean by scapegoating. So the very concept of scapegoat is being bracketed here because you are taking somebody inside, from inside, in order to, and throwing it outside in order to purify the inside. So this is how Derrida tries to problematize it. So the girl, for example, a very unattractive person might be chosen in order, and he is killed in order to purify the inside. Later, we know that symbolic killings were made. For example, instead of killing the person as such, you have certain effigies or certain statues being killed. So this idea of pharmakos is being questioned. Another idea is that of pharmakon. Pharmakon literally means drug, allurement, or poison. So it could mean, it could have different contradictory meanings. Socrates, as you know, never wrote anything. We know something about Socrates only through the writings of his student Plato. Socrates refers to written speech as pharmakon, as an allurement, or as a dangerous drug. So he never wrote anything. We know the Socratic method. He was going on asking questions. What is justice? What is beauty? What is liberty? And he never wrote anything. So according to Socrates, writing is wasteful and infertile, whereas speech is fertile and speech is a product of prudent agriculture. So writing is like a scapegoat because writing is pushed to the outside. So Derrida tries to look at the word pharmakon. The word pharmakon might mean poison as well as remedy. So why can't you use the word remedy when you read Socrates, and why can't you use that meaning, and why can't you say that that meaning is equally valid as the other meaning? So he's trying to problematize the whole idea of put forth by Socrates. So though Socrates did not write, it is through Plato's writings that we get an idea of Socrates. So many a time we are confused whether it is Socrates who is speaking of Plato, because in Plato's dialogues you have a character called Socrates who keeps on speaking, and we do not know whether Plato has given his own thoughts to Socrates or it is Socrates' own thoughts. But through his writings anyway, the very idea of the privileging of speech over writing is being questioned. If it's time, you can remind me, okay, if I'm exceeding the time. So Derrida is actually talking about the in-between spaces. For example, hymen. What is hymen? Hymen is the protective layer that is being punctured during the first sexual intercourse. Is hymen virginity or consummation? Hymen is a symbol of virginity, but it is realized only through consummation. So the very idea of virginity or consummation is being problematized through the example of hymen. Another example is that of supplement. Supplement means something that you add to something. Okay, so the supplement has two meanings. One is surplus. So if something is complete, for example, a newspaper is complete, you have a supplement coming in, it is just being added to it. Something, it is added to something that is already complete. Or it could also mean it is being added to something that is incomplete. So he is trying to play upon this meaning also. So if writing is supplement to speech, then he is trying to bracket the whole thing. Another thing is a frame, a photo frame or a portrait frame. Normally we do not look at the frame. It is what the picture that actually gives you meaning. But how is this picture really possible? This picture is really possible because of the frame. It is the frame that decides what is inside and what is outside. It is the frame that marks it, marks the boundary and makes the work of art possible. So frame marks the border between the work of art and whatever that lies outside it. So in that sense, so I hope you can understand what Derrida is trying to do. He is just talking about the in-between spaces which we have glossed over. So earlier, if we say that the meaning of the text was in the text, for example, what the new critics would say, Derrida would say a footnote or a casual allusion, or when I speak, a Freudian slip might actually be the real meaning. Next is Freud, of course. Freud was trying to visualize. Freud's idea of unconscious, we know. Earlier, we believed that we all were conscious of ourselves. We all knew what we are. But the conscious self is only the tip of the iceberg. And the real aspect of our personality lies in the unconscious, which is an abyss, an endless slippage, which you can never reach. Freud was trying to visualize a metaphor or a model that could explain how memory works. So how a pure virginal surface can harbor permanent traces. So he is actually talking about memory. This analogy is being used by Derrida. So Freud is actually talking about these things in order to describe the unconscious or the conscious. There are three layers. One is a wax slab. The other is a sheet of wax paper. The other is the celluloid. So the unconscious, conscious, and the subconscious. Writing or draw. So wax slab, what happens is you write on it with a sharp stylus. And if you want to write something on that again, you rewrite on it. So each time you use the same slab, and that slab has all the traces of what you have written before it. So the wax slab is like the unconscious because it retains permanent traces of whatever was inscribed into it. For example, I can take you, then I can hypnotize you. I can tell what was there in your memory when you were 2 years old. So wax slab is like an unconscious. And the celluloid and the translucent sheets are like conscious minds. So this idea is being taken by Derrida. He talks about his idea of palimpsest. Palimpsest is an Egyptian wax tablet on which you keep on writing. And this is his idea of traces. Every writing has got traces. No perception is virginal. This point I repeated earlier, no sign is pure. It is repeatable. It carries traces of previous signs. All perception is given meaning by a kind of pre-existing writing, by the traces of previous experiences, which themselves were influenced by the traces of the previous experience. So one experience leading you to another experience, leading into you into another experience, it is a slippage. Similarly, he uses the same paradigm in order to talk about language. This writing, because unconscious, is a writing that exists before speech. So this is something that is written in the mind. So this is actually a writing. This writing predates or pre-exists speech. Another theoretician that Derrida tries to question is Levi-Strauss. Levi-Strauss's work, which he talks about in The Structure, Sign and Play, is The Raw and the Coat. Levi-Strauss was a structuralist anthropologist. And you know what a structuralist anthropologist does. He tries to find out or devise certain common rules that are applicable to all cultures. that talking about the collective unconscious and all, from Jung it comes. So he tries to set out a grammar of myths. So he was trying to analyze myths, and he was trying to write the grammar of myths, and he used the central myth, the Bororo myth. Okay, the Bororo myth is the central myth. Now, before that, I would also like to talk about what a linguist, what a grammarian does. How are the rules of grammar produced? Is it possible to produce the rules of grammar after all the sentences in a language are produced? You cannot. Certain available sentences are there on the basis of which you design a grammar, and this grammar is very flexible because new sentences are being added. Similarly, the structuralist paradigm of the myth, they were trying to harp on some myth which they wanted to use as a reference point. This was the Bororo myth. Now, why this Bororo myth? So Derrida tries to question why, because no myth can be central. Strauss was actually trying to have a nostalgia for origin, and the Bororo myth can never be center because myths do not have centers as such. Myths are eccentric. This is a new word, maybe. Accentric. Earlier we were talking about centricity. We were talking about centers. All structures having a center. But myths are eccentric. They do not have a center. Then why does Levi-Strauss take this Bororo myth as the center? So there, Levi-Strauss also talks about the Nambiquara tribe in Brazil, which he idealizes for its primitive naturalness, which is also being questioned because they too have taboos, myths, codes, customs, which is also a form of writing. So you cannot say that these people who we call savages or noble savage or pristine inhabitants, they also had a form of writing. They also had certain rules. So totalization is not possible in this because the system is open. Structures are not closed. The structuralist was arguing for a closed structure where meaning is possible. So anything can be given meaning by placing it within this neatly drawn structure. Here, this whole concept of structure is being questioned by saying that structures are not closed. So if it is not closed, it doesn't have a center. So this nature-culture binary is being questioned here. So Derrida talks about an event which is a rupture. Well, which is that rupture? So an event means not just one event. In theory, event means something that connotes a paradigm shift. So the concept of structure was as old as Western science. Up to this event, which he calls rupture, structure was conceived to have a fixed origin or a center. This center balanced and organized the structure. It limited the free play of meaning. Center is what governs the structure, and center escapes structurality. Center is within the structure, but center governs the structure. So in that sense, center is both within and without. Center escapes structurality. Classical thought says that center is both inside and outside. The concept of centered structure is the concept of free play based on the fundamental ground which is beyond the reach of free play. That is, if you have a center, and movement is possible, but you cannot touch the center. For example, in a classroom, you can change your positions, but you can never change my position. So free play is possible, but there is a fundamental ground which is beyond the reach of free play. It is the transcendental signified, it is the divine, or whatever you call it. The whole history of structure has been a series of substitutions of center for center. The history of metaphysics is the history of these metaphors and metonymies. Metaphor and metonymy, substitution. So earlier, when you talk about the pre-Socratic period, what was at the center? Gods. Okay, you have these anthropomorphic gods that were at the center. When the classical period came, human rationality became at the center. When the Christian period came, God became at the center. Later, truth became at the center. Rationality became at the center. Imagination and emotion became at the center. So something is there always at the center, which is actually, so these are metaphors and metonymies that get replaced. Nobody has ever questioned the structure. It is with this post-structuralist discourse that the structure is being questioned. So center is rooted in presence. Derrida uses a few terms like eidos, archi, telos, Ousia, all of them mean almost the same. Eidos means essence. So Derrida was anti-essentialist. Archi means something that is prior. Derrida talks about archi writing, a writing that precedes all writing. Such a writing is not there, prior or original. Telos means an ultimate object or aim. Teleology, we say, for example, the Christian Islamic concept and all, you are born in heaven, you come to earth, you go back to heaven. It is teleological. So one thing is that Derrida challenges this, but definitely there are many people who still believe in this. So it's I'm just trying to look at how Derrida looks at this. Okay. This because metaphysics is still something that is relevant even during the pandemic period, we have seen that. So I'm not going into those discussions. So next is Ousia. Ousia, which again talks about essence. So rupture talks about the structurality of structure, which was a disruption. There were thoughts about the law which governed the center in the absence of a center. So now the center is being dismantled. It is eccentric. Everything becomes discourse. The absence of the transcendental signified extends the domain of signification ad infinitum, infinitely. Okay, it goes on and on. How did this decentering occur? Of course, the radical formulations of Nietzsche, Heidegger, and Freud, which we have been talking about. So it's very challenging because we have inherited these concepts through language. So Derrida tries to... Why does Derrida coin certain terms? Because when you use a word, you're not just taking that word. Derrida uses the term of atom. It is not just like an atom that you take. When you take that word, when you bring that word into discourse, you carry with it all the connotations associated with that word. So if you want to challenge that whole structure, you need to invent a new language. So how can we question them using the same language? That is why Derrida tries to talk about certain new coinages in order to deflect our attention from the usual way of conceiving reality. Now, ethnology. Regarding ethnology, he talks about how ethnology becomes a science when precisely this decentering takes place. Because ethnology is a science about marginal cultures. Not Europe, non-European cultures. For example, in our folklore departments, we might study Mapla culture, we might study Adivasi culture, but we might not study European culture. So ethnology is a branch of knowledge that came into being when this decentering took place. But Derrida says that this very idea of ethnology is ethnocentric because Europe is taken as the culture of reference, which actually makes the whole project ridiculous. And he tries to question this incest prohibition. So you have either nature or culture. Nature is something which is devoid of rules, which we have questioned in the earlier part of the lecture. And culture is something which talks about rules. What about incest? The prohibition to marry your brother or your father or your mother. Okay, this incest prohibition is there in almost all societies. So is incest a part of nature or culture? If it is a part, it is a part of culture because it is a rule, but it is not a part of, it is also a part of nature because it is natural to all cultures. It is natural to all societies. So in this sense, Derrida is trying to problematize certain taken for granted concepts. So respect for structurality or for the original internal originality of structure neutralizes time and history. This is what the structuralist project said, because we believed in structure. So it neutralizes time and history, isn't it? Because they said, so that is what Sashur was also talking about, a synchronic study of language. Whereas Derrida says, no, a diachronic approach is also needed, going into the etymology, going into the different words of pharmacon, how pharmacon would mean both this and that. So this is actually going beyond history. So this is how it moves one step further from structuralism. So appearance of a new structure comes about by a structure rupture with the past or its original cause. Now, the unfinalizability of meaning. This is the basic idea put forth by deconstruction. There is no outside text. It is not that you have a text, you have a reality outside there. That reality gets depicted in writing. There is no outside text. Everything is a text. Once you remove the center, every structure becomes a discourse. Hillis Miller has written a work called Critic as Host, where he tries to talk about the two probable meanings of host. Coast has a positive meaning today, but it also had a negative meaning historically. So, for example, if you come to my house and if I say you came to my house and I played the host, a deconstructivist would probably say that meaning is, I mean, would probably find it difficult to say whether I'm happy or sad. Okay, because both meanings are equally possible. Similarly, the word parasite also. Parasite, now it's a bad word, but earlier it had a positive connotation. When you deconstruct it, para and site, you have a new connotation, positive connotations. So finally, you reach aporia or deadlock. Meaning becomes impossible. So these are the basic ideas of deconstruction. Now, I would also like to talk about the Poldemann controversy, which came out in 1987. Poldemann, I've not gone into, Poldemann was talking about the figurative and the rhetorical meanings and all. So Poldemann was a major critic of the Yale School. But in 1980, essays of his were brought out which he had written when he was young, which was anti-Semitic, which was supporting the Nazi cause. This became a big controversy, and they were trying to question. People all rose up in revolt against this Poldemann, and Derrida came to his rescue. Derrida tried to deconstruct Poldemann's essays, and Derrida was trying to talk about what is responsibility. He was trying to ask about some larger questions, which actually brought the whole movement into disrepute, because in one sense, deconstruction would mean becoming utterly irresponsible for what you are trying to say. Now, Derrida also had a political purpose. This is something that we know, because he was born as a Jew in Algiers. He was even denied entry into school. He was denied scholarship. So this dismantling the center and trying to talk about a margin was actually a part of his political project. And the whole idea of deconstruction and post-structuralism emerged from the disillusionment with the grand theories, the philosophies of emancipation that emerged in the 20th century. This I end my discussion, and definitely this is just a very rudimentary lecture. If you want more, we can have one more session where I can give you practical examples on how deconstruction works. Now you can just air your views or queries or whatever.
Any questions or doubts or queries? Feel free to ask or put it in the chat box.
My voice was breaking. That was what I. Was it true for all?
No, it's just in the beginning, ma'am. Not right. Not right now. And there's a question. Can you see the chat box?
Yes. Could you explain the connection between Bororo myth and raw and cooked concept? Raw and cooked is actually another binary. Raw is something that is available, and cooked is something that is refined. So Derrida is trying to problematize that very structure. And Bororo myth is a myth that was taken as a central reference point in order to talk about myths. But Derrida asks, how can you take one particular myth as the central point of reference when the whole structure of myth is itself open. It is endless. It is infinite. Okay, maybe you can talk about the example of the wax slab or the palimpsest, where it retreats, where it regresses into infinity. So how can you talk about one particular myth becoming the reference point? So Derrida, in his essay, he's actually trying to question Plato, Rousseau, Levi-Strauss, primarily three philosophers from three different ages, in order to question these the ideas that they were trying to talk about. So structuralist anthropologists very conveniently assumed, for example, you have James G. Fraser, he talks about in his Golden Bough how myths are very common. You have all these were derived from Jung's collective unconscious, because human beings think in a very similar way. So Virgin Mary story is there in common in many myths across the world. So they were trying to share certain basic myths, which are the reference points on the basis of which other myths can be developed. So Derrida is questioning why this particular myth is being taken, because when the whole idea of myth escapes the structurality. Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am, it is clear, it seems. Ma'am, can you see the question? Another question has popped up.
Yeah, collective unconscious in the sense, of course, collective unconscious can never be negated, but working in very similar fashion and in order to arriving at a structural analysis on the basis of that, that is something that Derrida, of course, questions. We all think in the same way, all societies think, so certain common paradigms are being established on the basis of which all myths, all philosophies are being judged. This is something that Derrida questions.
Is there any more questions? I think might wind up the lecture. If they have any queries, they could discuss it in the group, or I'll definitely ask them if they need another session, because I think one or two I've already asked about another practical session with you. So
okay, okay.
We'll fix a date and let them know. We have to know your convenience also. Anyway, thanks for the lecture. It was a very interesting session, because deconstruction is always a confusing topic for the students and the teachers as well. I'm pretty sure that even the teachers in the group have taken from your lecture. On behalf of the theory project and department college, I sincerely thank Dr. Abida Farooqi for spending her valuable time to help us construct a notion of what this deconstruction is all about. Thank you, ma'am. Waiting for another session from you. Thank you.
Okay, thank you for inviting me. Okay, thank you all for your patient listening. Maybe we'll have another session another day. Okay, thank you all.